Welcome. Today, I am announcing a new series of lectures on high-risk pregnancies. But before we start, let me define for you high-risk pregnancy in my own words. As you see, this series is potent with immense linkage analysis to be provided. Further, due to the highest prevalence of cardiac disorders among the diseases that endanger mother and child, I have divided my coverage into two major groups, cardiac and non-cardiac. In this slide, I list only cardiovascular disorders stratified to present minimal, moderate, and high risks that they pose to pregnant women, parturients, and fetus. In the next slide, I list the non-cardiac disorders, again to be covered by this series. Each lecture will present one disease. The disorders are neither prioritized by me nor selected. Rather, they are ruffled in this container and picked up randomly. Today's pick was myasthenia gravis. The etiology of this grave disease is multifactorial, inclusive of Epstein-Barr virus, thymic inflammation or tumor, paraneoplastic pemphigus, thyroid disease, systemic lupus erythematosus, and even extensive stress, to name a few. The pathogenesis is more precise. This disease is caused by antibodies targeting the postsynaptic membrane proteins of the neuromuscular junction in striated muscles. As you may know, the striated muscles include the skeletal muscles and the cardiac muscle or myocardium. This is an incurable disease, but with a wide range of treatment modalities, which you will read through slides 25 to 32, where I have thoroughly provided management plans and medications used for myasthenia treatment that are contraindicated in pregnancy, as well as medications commonly used in pregnancy and labor that worsen the course of myasthenia gravis. I also present diagnostic tests for both ocular and systemic forms of myasthenia. In addition, differential diagnostics are provided. You may ask, why would myasthenia affect the pregnancy if the uterine muscle myometrium isn't a striated skeletal muscle? A fair question. And the answer is that indeed the disease cannot directly impact the myometrial function, but can impair the striated muscles of the diaphragm or thoracic muscles that participate in breathing exercises, or the muscles of the abdominal wall and pelvic floor that are crucial in aiding stage 2 labor. Next, the myocardium is also a striated muscle, and there are studies indicating that the heart muscle is also directly or indirectly affected by myasthenia gravis. Besides, certain medications commonly used during pregnancy, such as magnesium, or labor, such as local or inhalation anesthetics, should be avoided at all costs in myasthenia patients. In this slide, I explain how the maternal acetylcholine receptor antibodies cross the placenta and induce transient muscular weakness in newborns, and list the adverse neonatal outcomes, which include pulmonary aplasia, transient hyperbilirubinemia, and AMC. Tips for breastfeeding are also provided with the names of medications to be avoided by nursing mothers with myasthenia. The legal section presents three court holdings over mismanaged myasthenia cases in pregnancy, followed by 14 review questions and the answer key. Now, I'm not going to read all my 46 slides ad verbatim. I will let you read those alone at your chosen pace and space, either muted or with background music. One last thing before I leave. Your solidary trail will start from slides where I group the muscles by their composition and function, followed by the signaling pathways for each type of muscle. And the discussion about the disease itself will start on slide 15. Best of luck, and see you next time, when the ruffle pulls the next disease.